We've learned how to use say nodes to output something to a user. Let's learn how to ask questions using question nodes. Question nodes output something to the user and then wait for a response that matches the validation rules configured in the question node. Once a valid response has been received, the flow continues its execution with the node following the question node. Let's look at an example. I'll say hi to start the flow. Yes, I'm checking bags. Note the green caret next to the question node. This indicates the current entry point for the flow. That means when the user answers the question, instead of starting with the start node, Cognigy will start with this question node. This is one of the key features of a question node. It's a bookmark in a flow that tells Cognigy where it needs to start when the next user input comes in. Entry points are an important concept in Cognigy, and we'll learn more about them in other lessons. I'm a heavy packer, so I'll say 3. When I enter 3, Cognigy outputs the say node, then outputs the question node, then waits for the next user input. And I'm flying to San Francisco, or SFO, and Cognigy celebrates my decision. Now I'll start over and provide some different answers. When it asks, will you check any bags, I'll say 3. Cognigy says, not sure I understood this correctly. Will you check any bags? If I say yes, the conversation will continue. Similarly, when it asks, how many bags will you check, I'll say, I don't know, and the system will again tell me that it didn't understand me. I'll say 3 and continue the conversation. This may seem limiting, but it's by design. We also have ways to handle inputs that don't have to match a validation rule, but in this case I've configured the question nodes to look for specific answer types. Let's start from scratch and look at the different configuration options for question nodes. I'll create a new question node and click on it to open the Edit Node panel. At the top, you see the question node type, which I'll leave at Yes or No for now. The next few fields are the same fields you'll see in a Say node. The output type, and the options work exactly the same way as a Say node. Let's take a look at the reprompt questions. These settings tell Cognigy what to do if the user says something that doesn't match the question type. So if it's a yes-no question and the user says maybe, we can prompt them to give a more precise answer. I'll add please answer yes or no for my reprompt message. I also have the option to repeat the question after the reprompt message. There's also a field for a reprompt condition. We'll talk about conditions in the Flow Developer Training. For now, let's see it in action. I'll say hi, then I'll say maybe. Note that it sends the reprompt message and then asks the question again. If I turn off repeat question, it will just give me the reprompt message. Now let's output the answer to the user. I'll create a say node and I'll enter you said, and then I'll choose last question result as my token. When I test it out, it says you said true instead of you said yes. That's because Cognigy stores the result of the yes-no question internally as true or false. I'll leave the say node there so we can see other examples for different question types. What if the user doesn't say yes or no? They might say sure, or that's right, or yep. Let's try it again and I'll say sure. Cognigy recognizes sure as an affirmative answer and continues with the flow. I'll try again, and I'll say that's right. Cognigy doesn't recognize this as an affirmative answer, and it asks me for a yes or no. If I want to add to Cognigy's list of affirmative or negative answers, I can. go to the left bar and find Manage, then Settings. You'll see the option to add additional positive confirmation words. I'll add That's Right to the list. I'll test my flow again and say that's right. Now it recognizes this as an affirmative response. Now let's change the question type to a date question. I'll change my text to what is the date. For my say node, I'll choose the first date slot instead of last question result. I'll save, and let's see what happens. Note that it asks me the date and also presents a Pick Date button. Cognigy will show the date picker if the user is chatting through our out-of-the-box web chat client. The Say node responds with Cognigy's internal representation of the answer. Let's look at different date inputs Cognigy will recognize. I'll start the flow and say next Tuesday. That works. Now I'll say 2 weeks from now. And that works too. How about a number question type? I'll make the text be pick a number. In my Say node, I'll choose First Number Slot. That's straightforward. How about a money question type? I'll change my text to How Much Money? And my Say node to use the first currency slot. When it asks how much money, I'll say 4 stacks of $600. Note that it returns 600. It sees the 4 as a general number and the 600 as the currency value. I want to show 3 more question types that are unique. The first is a slot question type. This will match any slot name you've entered in a question. We haven't learned about lexicons yet, but when I created this agent in Cognigy, I uploaded the airport code's lexicon. I'll enter the special key phrase name under slot name, airport code, and I'll change the question to which airport. In my Say node, I'll just output the last question result. I'll test it out by saying hi, then SFO. You'll learn more about lexicons and slot names in later chapters, but it's good to remember this question type is available. It can be useful in cases like airport codes, where you're looking for a specific answer from a large list of possible answers. The second I want to show is a regex question type. Regex stands for regular expression, and it refers to a standard for describing patterns in text. For example, you might have a regular expression for a phone number or an email address. Cognigy will check to see if it gets the expected pattern match and treat that as an answer to the question. Let's imagine we need the user's social security number. First thing I'll do is go online and search for a social security number regex. In the regular expression field, I'll enter this. Note that I start and end the regular expression with forward slashes. If you enter something that's not a valid regular expression, you'll get an error message. And for the text, I'll say, "What's your social?" If I test it out, I'll say 12345, and I'll get my reprompt answer. If I say 12345678989, I get a confirmation. Lastly, there is a text question type. This will accept anything the user enters. So if I say, "How are you?" And I answer good, I'll hit my say node regardless of what I enter. We know how to ask questions now, but let's look at what to do with the answers. By default, the answer is stored in the Cognigy input. That's why I've been able to use those tokens in my say node like last question result or first date slot. Let's look under advanced to see additional options. If I select Store Detailed Results, Cognigy won't just store the answer, it will also store the value, question, timestamp, and the answer in the Cognigy input. I can also enable Skip if answer and input. Let's take a look at how this could be useful. I'll add another question at the top and make it a number question, and I'll say how many tickets. If I go through the flow, I'll first say 3, and then say SFO. That makes sense. Now let me do it again, and I'll say 3 tickets to SFO. Note that it skipped the airport question because it already had the answer in my input to the prior question. That's what Skip if answer and input does for us. So far, I've said that the answers are stored in the Cognigy input. We'll learn more about the Cognigy input in later chapters. One limitation of storing the answers in the Cognigy input is that they go away when the user inputs something else. I'll copy my say node under my first question to show what I mean. Notice that the say nodes output the last question result from the Cognigy input, so prior to responding to each question, it knows the answer from the previous question. But what if I reach the end of my flow and want to know how many tickets? That information isn't available anymore because the Cognigy input has changed. We can persist answers through the conversation by writing them to the Cognigy context. In my question node, if I go to context, I can choose Store Result in Context. That presents a new field, context key to use. Think of this as an identifier for the answer that I can reference later. So for this question, I might make the key be airport. That way I can refer to this in the Cognigy context later in the conversation, maybe when I'm looking up the user's flight status in an external database. We'll talk about the Cognigy context and how to access it more in future lessons. The last thing I want to share about question nodes is the option to store values in profile storage. As I mentioned before, the Cognigy input persists just until the user enters a new input. The Cognigy context exists throughout the conversation. The Cognigy profile persists throughout the user's history across multiple conversations. If I write the result to the contact profile, I see a new dropdown, Profile Key to Use. This lets me assign the user's input to the user's profile. This is helpful, for example, if you're asking for the user's name and you want to use that information in future conversations. Like with the Cognigy context, we haven't yet talked about how to access profile values, but we will. In the following chapters, we'll learn how to apply logic that allows the system to respond differently depending on the user's answer.